Kang, he's a Balchinian.
Welcome, everyone, to episode 500 of an Unearthly Podcast, streaming live on January 23, 2023. Oh, that's an interesting coincidence. In our 250th episode, we reviewed the Stephen Moffat era. Well,
did you say it's 2023?
Oh shit! I haven't updated that, I guess. So it's not as much coincidence as I thought.
Well, we have slipped backwards in time, folks. Hello.
In our 250th episode, way back when we did that, we reviewed the Stephen Moffat era of Doctor Who. Well, we are now double that, episode 500. And even though it doesn't quite line up, although it could have if we hadn't had such a weird couple of years, we are doing the Christopher Chibnall era of Doctor Who, starring Jodie Whittaker as the Doctor, Mandip Gill as Yasmin Khan, Tosin Cole as Ryan Sinclair, Bradley Walsh as Graham O'Brien, and John Bishop as Dan Lewis. I am Bill Sylvia, the one in black, and with me are technical director Mad Matt Winchell.
I still live despite the many rumors.
And color commentator Alex Fireheart.
Well, it is the 24th of the first 24 here, so...
Oh, it is, yeah, that... for you. Yep. How's it going today, this week?
Well, I did get that... I did get that money back, thankfully. A lot quicker than I was expecting, in fact. I think it came back through, like, either... the day after or 2 days after the podcast. So that was like, wow, that was a quick turnaround. I mean, that to me says that, like, because it one went through and the other was still pending, that their end must have caught it and were like, oh shit, whoops. So while there is still a decent chunk of money that I'm never getting back that I had to use to get myself out of the red, at least I got that back. So now I've got a lot more money. So I'm just going to be very good because I'm going to have, when we're done here, I'm probably going to have to do some grocery shopping because this cyclone's probably going to blow through in the next 2 days. So that's going to suck.
Speaking of going into red, I just got out of that myself. Amazon apparently didn't charge me for a wallet that I needed to buy because my wallet was officially breaking down. The coin pouch had finally broken on it, so I couldn't keep coins in it, and that was the main reason I've kept it for over 20 years. So I had to buy a new one at great expense. Finally found one with a decent coin pouch, which I thought was a snap, but actually turns out to be a magnet clip.
Oh, so nice.
So it's a little bit nicer than I thought it was going to be. But they
That's something I need to get next time, especially if I go to Europe again, which I should eventually, right? I've never had a wallet that I could safely keep coins in without them falling out.
Oh, yeah. I killed myself sooner than I would willingly buy a coin pouch. Just keep everything in my wallet, goddammit. But yeah, Amazon in their wisdom, I didn't realize, had not yet charged me until like literally the night before it arrived. And so the next day, the day before it was arriving, I thought to myself, oh, nothing's going to chum up any charges. I can spend like $15 on gas and get at least most, if not all, my gas tank filled, and I should be good for a couple more days. And then I look at my bank account the next day and it's negative eight. But then I get a check in the mail the same day I gave my wallet, and it's a $40-some check for my live streaming. My, like, barely once a year check. So I quickly took that to the bank today, but by the time I got it in, it was already too late, and they charged me another $30. So basically all of it's gone already.
Aww.
I'm no longer in debt, but that sucks. Especially since I didn't know they were going to all finish coming in on the morning of. It's like, come on, you guys could at least give me like a couple hours to get done and in. But yeah, I used cash to get some lunch on my way out, headed home, and apparently since I've been home, my mother dropped off another $20 she owed me for groceries and other things. So that's settled things in there for a while. I might grab some snacks on my way out of work tomorrow. Especially since I just finished eating what I had left of the little baggy chips. Yeah. I think that's been mostly my biggest thing this week. It's been otherwise just the swings and roundabouts at work. We either have fairly busy days and sometimes hours pass by like it's nothing, or we have really slow days and sometimes you occasionally get sent home a few minutes early, to which I shrug and go, oh, well, it makes up for the fact that they give me an extra half hour every Wednesday lately. Yeah, I'm waiting for that big first full week check to come in now on Thursday. That's going to be nice, and it's not going to be a check that's going to be immediately eradicated by a bill. Which means I get to keep it and actually spend it on things I need and maybe a couple of things here or there I might want.
It almost sounded like you capitalized the B, and I was like, I'm not taking your money since when? And my brain kind of caught up with my ears.
Trying to think, is there anything else? That's about it for me right now.
My biggest news is that it's playing the catch-up. Start of the... my biggest news is it's the start of the spring semester. So I've just had to buy my textbooks and such and get things started. And then I suddenly realized, oh yeah, my trip to San Diego is already in 2 weeks. So that's my main thing that I'm focused on until then. And of course, that's also why rather than starting our 20th season in 2 weeks, we're holding off until the following week.
Because Bill will probably not be available that week.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm probably... Knowing me when I fly, I'm going to get to San Diego, check into the hotel, and then crash onto bed. And then after I sleep for 4 or 5 hours, I wake up and hope that there's still someone to DoorDash. And I'm guessing in San Diego, near the convention center, there's probably lots of 24-hour DoorDash.
Oh, I'm pretty sure you'll be... well, accustomed for.
Yeah.
Especially if it's a town that's used to visitors.
Mm-hmm. Well,
air quotes.
It's the neighborhood of the San Diego Convention Center. Like, tourism is their business. And, or should I say, big groups of people are their business.
Yeah.
All right. On tonight's show, we have our birthdays and news. Then we have some geek talk. No episode summary because we're not summarizing three seasons. And then we will take to putting together our tier list. Mm-hmm. So we start with Alex with the birthdays.
Yep. So first up on the 17th of January, we have Malcolm Clark. I was a composer of incidental music from 72 to 86. Would have been 81, but died in 2003 at the age of 60. On the 18th, we have Christopher Bidmead, who was the script editor from 80 to 81, and a writer through 1984 and also in Big Finish since, turned 83. Also on the 18th, we have Donald Braverstock, or Braverstock, depending, who was the controller of programs for BBC One during the creation of Doctor Who, would have been 100, but died in 1995 at the age of 71. On the 20th, we have the big one, Tom Baker, who was a doctor from 75 to 81 and has since done some Big Finish and, you know, was a curator, blah, 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 narrator for Little Britain. Turned 90. So, well past.
Ten more years.
The immortal has been found.
And on the 22nd, first we have Tommy Knight, who played Luke Smith from 07 to 2011. Turned 31. Oh, I keep forgetting he's younger than me. And finally, we have John Hurt, also on the 22nd, who was the war doctor in the 50th anniversary special, as well as some Big Finish. Would have been 84, but died in 2017 at the age of 77. So happy birthday to Malcolm, Christopher, Donald, Tom, Tommy, and John.
Right, moving on to our Doctor Who news. First off, this one has followed a convoluted path, but we've been paying attention to it. So, first off, the Mirror announced that Millie Gibson was leaving Doctor Who during the 2025 series, meaning after several episodes of her second season. Some websites and tabloids and whatnot have taken this news and added things like axed and dropped and diva and all of these things that we have no evidence of. Keeping in mind that the typical Russell T. Davies companion is only a companion for 1 year. So all we know is that at some after a few episodes in the 2025 season, Millie Gibson appears to no longer be the companion. In terms of we don't know causes, we do know more than that. The same report, or another report at least, indicates that 32-year-old Varada Sethu, who apparently seems to be best known from Star Wars Andor, which I still haven't watched because I didn't have Disney Plus while that was airing, has been picked up as the next companion. Now, some people pointed out how odd this is that we know the next companion before we've even seen an episode of next season. The closest thing I can compare it to in modern Doctor Who history is, I believe, David Tennant was announced as the Doctor before Rose was aired. That's probably the closest thing in terms of having this kind of foreknowledge before even seeing their predecessor, except we've seen Ruby Sunday in one episode. Following on from that news, which this also kind of confirms at least some of it, there has been some filming scene with Shuti Gatwa and Varada Sethu. I'm not entirely sure the correct pronunciation. And this seems to be in an area that was set up to appear to be the 1950s. Dressed up as a 1950s movie theater in Miami, Florida.
So generally a very awkward time to have a...
Have a black doctor and a South Asian companion. Yeah, true. Yeah. But, I mean, if you live in Miami, it's illegal for you to be taught how awkward that would be. So maybe it's okay not. I don't think there's anything else worth really commenting on in these photos. Yeah, there doesn't seem to be any monster that we can see, although I doubt it's a true historical. So that is it for our episode news. And we move on to merchandising. Is it anti-Semitic to always use that pronunciation every time I say the word? I hope not.
No,
it's just a
joke.
Mel
it's a
Brooks
Spaceballs
reference.
Joke.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's just right.
Yeah,
merchandising.
I know it's fine for Mel Brooks to do it. I just don't know if it's fine for me to do it.
As far as I'm aware, the Jewish people don't care that they use Yiddish as long as you're not taking a piss on them. I'm not taking a piss on Mel Brooks. He's hilarious.
Right. Okay. But we have an announcement of an action figure and TARDIS set for the. They call her the Fugitive Doctor. I still don't like that name.
Yeah.
I'd rather call her the Division Doctor. Hell, the first and second Doctors were fugitives. But either way, the Ruth Doctor with her rifle is now available as an action figure and also with a TARDIS.
You know what? I would probably only buy it just to at least get the TARDIS. I don't care that much about Ruth because Flux kind of ruined her for me.
Yeah.
And also the whatever child, the timeless child or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But just
well,
that,
so
I don't even remember the last time they had a TARDIS toy. Do you recall them ever having a TARDIS toy?
I honestly don't know because I like these action figure announcements go in one ear and out the other for me.
I could have sworn maybe they had some play sets back in the day of the interior, but I don't remember the last time they had an exterior TARDIS toy.
I do not have the budget to collect TARDIS action figure or Doctor Who action figures. And if I did, it would have to be every Doctor. I'm not somebody who would just pick a favorite Doctor and buy one.
I'm collecting reactions, and I'm just buying whatever floats my fancy.
Gotcha.
My first three were Michael, Jason, and Freddy.
So this is available, I think it's...
Actually, that'd be nice to get some Doctor Who stuff on reaction.
Okay, so it's not a pre-order. It's available for sale from Character Online for £40.
Available yesterday.
Yep. In the UK, it's free delivery. I doubt it's free delivery for any of us. I'm curious if I click it, if it automatically calculates. Give me a few
pond
seconds.
Shipping.
Huh?
Pond shipping.
Right, yeah. So let's see. Well, it doesn't automatically... I'm not going to go through and put all my details in. So it doesn't automatically calculate that I'm in the U.S. But I'm sure it's not free shipping in the U.S.
Well, I guarantee it. That'd be an arm and a leg that no business in the U.K. would pay for.
Right.
Yeah. Best I can tell, this toy must be part of, like, a new entry in a line where they seem to give you, like, you get a figure of whatever Doctor and the version of the TARDIS that they were with.
Makes sense.
Seemingly. I found one randomly Googling for the sixth Doctor. Apparently there was a second Doctor one, so I'm assuming there was a first, fourth, etc.
I'll have to do some digging.
And our next piece, we have... Candy Jar Books, I guess, now that they're done with the Lethbridge Stewart novels, 2024 will see the launch of their unit range of original novels.
Ah, the next step.
Yep, so this starts back at the Invasion and branches out from there. The first book announced is The Vaughn Identity, which focuses on the background of Tobias Vaughn, which I believe was the human antagonist of the Invasion. And it can be pre-ordered from the Candy Jar Books website. It's £24 plus shipping as part of a two-book bundle, apparently.
Interesting. Yeah. I'm noticing on the art, what I assume is Mr. Vaughn here, has something that looks like it could resemble 1960s Cybermen tech on his chest.
Makes sense, because he was involved in the invasion, so.
So there could be a tie there, yes.
Yep. And I don't think I said the author is Tim Cambrell. And yeah, that is it for that piece of news.
The next step has
Then we
begun.
go to Alex with Big Finish.
So as far as new releases go, on the 18th of January, Big Finish released Torchwood Poppet, written by Lauren Mooney and Stuart Pringle, and starring Kai Owen. On the 23rd of January, Big Finish released First Doctor Adventures, Fugitive of the Daleks, written by Jonathan Morris, starring Stephen Noonan and Maureen O'Brien. God, we really are running out of the Daleks titles. There's only so many things you could put before that.
True.
Nah, we can find more. Keep digging.
What if, since we're paused on that, I found it interesting. This is old Vicky and not, Vicky in a time period that I'm familiar with anyway. Like,
Well,
that's clearly a Vicky older than middle age returned to the TARDIS.
also, wasn't she left in, I believe, Greece or Rome?
I think it was Troy.
Yeah, it
Because it
was
was
during
the
the
myth
Troy
maker. Yeah,
invasion.
that sounds
Troy,
right.
yeah.
That sounds right. The myth makers, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that would have been Troy.
So it'd be interesting to see how she comes back at all.
I do
All
find it
right.
interesting that they did
So go.
art for it rather than trying to just piece together random shots they might have had.
Which that might also be because they're not using a the they're using an impressionist for the doctor. Or a recast, maybe not a professional impressionist, but a recast. But yeah, I don't think they always do that for their recasts, so. All right. Moving so we're making great time, which is partially because there's not a huge amount of news.
Which is fair
But
enough.
moving on to Geek Talk.
Yes.
So
So first up on here is Archer.
yes, so Archer's final season ended shortly before Christmas. But there hasn't been another time to talk about it on podcast since then. So this season was clearly written as a final season, with Archer contemplating his mortality and several episodes focusing on whether or not spy agencies would become internationally outlawed. It also set a tone that the characters will go on. There's a big focus on Lana taking Mallory's place and trying to run the agency according to her own ethics. While this season sometimes felt like a greatest hits with many past enemies returning, although other seasons also had that too, I felt it still couldn't quite reach the highs of the early seasons when the characters were capable of genuinely surprising the audiences. I would say it is at least as good as any of the past 7 seasons or so.
Fair enough. Not a lot of surprises, but it's a decent run.
Right.
And finally a closer, at least for now.
Well, they did say this would be the final season, unless somebody convinces them to have a reunion.
Or do one of those spin-off ideas that might be coming out of this, but yeah.
All right. Next is video games.
Lethal Company.
I think it was over a week ago now. I was invited to play Lethal Company with someone I know. And it's interesting thus far. I mean, it's funny because we basically played it vanilla because while everyone else wanted to play with mods, I'm like, I haven't played the game yet, so I'd rather like experience it as it's intended first before I bother venturing into mods. And also, I'm just iffy about having to add on stuff to something that's in Steam and whatever. But anyway, it was an interesting experience. I died twice very quickly in the first two rounds, so that kind of sucked. But we got the hang of it after a while, because it was like, of the like four of us, one person had played it before and the rest of us hadn't.
So it's just the one person leading the screaming babes into the halls of horror.
Pretty much. I mean, it was very funny because there was one time where the most experienced person of us was just like, okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to stay in the ship and you lot are going to go and grab stuff and then come back. And we actually managed to find stuff very quickly that was worth a lot and then brought it back. Because I guess for those who don't quite know the premise of it, effectively you are working for this, I forget if the company has a name, but effectively you're going into these dangerous locations, usually just kind of seems like disused industrial places for the most part, with flashlights that only have so much charge, so you can't just have them on constantly. But you do have a rechargeable thing in your ship. And you're just trying to grab all the stuff you can that's worth money while trying to avoid all these monsters and that you can't really fight. I mean, you can buy stuff like shovels and that to whack them with, but some it's just better off running away from. And some you basically can't escape. But yeah, there's... And like, the funny thing is if any of you die, you get revived for the next day, but you get a fine for having died. That being said, if you recover the corpse, if there's a way to, if you're like, they didn't just fall off a cliff or anything, so the body's gone. If you grab the body quickly enough and bring it back to the ship, that will actually technically give you some money back. And yeah, there was, I forget it. I think there was like a time, there was once where we all died. And so the ship just took off without us. Because it realized that, oh yeah, all their life signs are gone. See ya. And there was once where we took too long getting back out. So by the time we were like, we were almost there, and the ship took off and left us, because you only have like X amount of time to grab stuff, and we took too long, so it was like, whoops. So at one point we just got into a habit of like, okay, we've got a crap ton of stuff on the ship, instead of selling all of it, we'll sell as much as we need to meet the quota and keep everything else, so that if we fuck up, we've still got plenty to thing out. But yeah, interesting so far. I mean, I think it's only an early access game, so it'll be interesting to see how it develops from here, but it seems fairly solid so far. Okay. I would definitely recommend people check it out, especially because it's like, I mean, it would probably be very, very cheap in the US, because for in Australian money, it costs me like... Yeah, like I think it was like around 14 to 15 bucks Australian, so that would be around 10 or a bit on.
Yeah.
In US. The last couple of days, Pal World just suddenly like took over.
Yes.
The freaking Pokemon was survival and guns.
I haven't watched anybody play it yet.
I've seen clips of a VTuber I like playing it, and she is like having the absolute squeeze, and she's not one for normally doing that, so
somebody already made it. It's not a surprise. Somebody made a mod to put actual Pokemon in it. And
that's
Pokemon
not surprising
company,
at all. No.
The Pokemon company was immediately like DMCA.
yeah not surprised.
Seemingly the reason that was done is because they were apparently putting them behind a paywall. They were putting those Pokemon mods behind a paywall. So.
Oh, that's a big no. Yeah.
That's interesting because apparently the person.
They might not have.
What I had heard was that they wanted to make it freely available, but because the Pokemon company jumped on their video so quick, they're like, yeah, I'm not going to unless I know I'm not going to be sued for making it available.
Hmm. Yeah, for like,
I mean,
from
yeah,
what
if it is behind a paywall, that's always gonna fuck you. Like,
yeah, that's
you do
it's
not
the
want to put
game
somebody
now.
You do not want to put a big company's IP behind your paywall. They will find you and they will take your money.
They will take your money and they will force you to shut down your business. But Lethal Company $9.99, and that's not even on sale.
All right, so yeah, we've made good time. But we don't know how long this tier list is going to take. Because this is our first time doing something like this.
A very, very long time.
Okay. Yep. So we can bring that up.
So we're bringing up what now?
The tier list for our so that we can do our rankings.
Where am I supposed to find this?
It's right on our outline document as a link below Geek Talk.
Let's see here. Geek Talk tier list. Oh, copy link address. And we're just gonna put it right on top of this. Yoink. I said yoink. There we go. Oh gosh, we're actually gonna fight with each other over where these episodes go.
I mean, I don't know about fight, but yeah. Well, at least say all of our own rankings. There is also there's a presentation mode down at the bottom. I don't know how much that changes about the view.
Presentation mode. Oh. That makes it much easier to fit the screen. Thank you.
Ah. Oh, there we go. Yep. Now I see what it looks like. All right. So, yes. So, our first one, we have The Woman Who Fell to Earth. So, how do we want... I mean, So, Matt and I talked briefly about this, but I'm not sure you had seen what we were working on because you sound very surprised right now.
Yeah. I was thinking...
So,
we
now,
just
now you get why I was
about,
asking
like...
if you wanted to moderate and be the end, right?
Sure. Yeah, now I understand a little bit better. Okay.
All right. I just said the word so like five times. I wrote out what I wanted to say for each of them because I knew that otherwise I would take forever and I wasn't sure how much introducing each of them would need. So Woman Who Fell to Earth. This is only the third time we had an opening like that. We got to know all of the companions, and then the Doctor crashes in from out of nowhere. Helps the Doctor feel more like an alien than most openings, and this episode to feel more like a movie. It's a great introduction to the Chibnall era, and I penalized it for Grace's death when I first came out, but looking at what came after, I don't think it needs that penalty anymore. I would say somewhere an 8, A or S.
Mm.
Alex,
I feel like
Alex, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like watching this back, I still really like it. I mean, it was weird noticing I brought up to Bill kind of in a way like semi-jokingly that I noticed, of all the deaths in this, only one person is white. That's a bit odd. but yeah, like I feel like for me, in hindsight, I don't know if I thought this at the time, probably not. Because like at first, it was just kind of annoying that Grace died because Grace was an interesting character. So it was like, damn it, why'd you kill her off? But also in hindsight, it's like, oh, they fridged her. Because that's Graham's whole thing.
See, that's what I felt like in the beginning. But over time, I just kind of more like, one, it feels like she would have taken over the show if she had stayed alive. And two, like they, you know, it was intentional. Like she was worked into the story over time.
Well, yeah. She at
It did
least
def I
had
mean, definitely
agency and.
Graham did definitely have a mourning arc and like a coming to, you know,
Yeah.
coming to terms and the five stages of grief and everything.
Just had something
But
pop
yeah,
up
I
that I was
guess
trying to
like.
update or something. It's like, don't know what you are, but you can be told no right now.
Right. I don't
Yeah.
think it came up on the our screen.
Okay.
Yeah, like I think the one thing that saves it a little bit is just generally that she had agency in her death, which
Yeah.
in most cases when it's considered fridging, they don't.
Like she wasn't killed specifically to be like, "Look, Graham, now suffer."
Yeah. Or to like motivate him to into action or anything.
Right.
But yeah. But yeah, like this does hold up surprisingly well. I mean, it is kind of annoying that the dyspraxia stuff with Ryan is effectively dropped.
Yeah.
Because they just keep
Mostly.
forgetting to portray it. Yeah, they're like
they
they
mention it
bring it
a
up here and
little bit,
there.
but
They
yeah.
mention here and there, but it's not as often as it should be.
Yeah, so it's very. But that's more of an issue with
That's
like
more of an
stuff
issue
that
with
comes
future
later
episodes,
rather
yeah.
than this. Yeah. But yeah, fairly still a fairly solid opening. I would put it around A. I feel like it's just got just enough to keep it out of S.
Yeah, I'm definitely saying this is definitely an A for me as well. I definitely like this quite a lot. I don't think it's perfect. I don't think it's blowing me out of the water episode, but it is definitely a very good episode. So I'm definitely very much leaning towards A tier as well.
Okay. And yeah, since you're the one stream, you can physically just when you say yours, you can just physically put it in the right spot. I
So
will
then.
say now, since we're, you know, since these are, since there's no like A.5, B.5, I'm not going to be updating any of our scores based on what we say on this, or just assuming this is separate. Even though I did use our scores to somewhat inform my ratings, but not only the ones that I didn't get to watch very clearly.
Yeah.
All right, the Ghost Monument. So my comments, this story ties into the idea of the season being one long story, and even foreshadows the Timeless Children, which I didn't notice, or at least didn't know what that meant at first. The idea of the planet being made hostile feels like it wasn't paid off as much as it could have been. And in retrospect, this is the start of the Chibnall era just being a little slower paced than we were used to compared to the prior two showrunners. I would say high B or low A.
Yeah, I remember. I mean, it's funny going by the ratings chart you made. I gave this the same as Woman Who Fell to Earth, but yeah, it's one of those things where like
Yeah, they were both four point.
watching
Yeah,
it,
4.5
yeah.
is about for you.
Which is funny because like watching. I did get to rewatch like a couple of episodes from series 11 before I got distracted and kept putting it off. And rewatching this was interesting. I don't think my opinions changed of it all that much. Definitely didn't skew negative, thankfully. It's one of those ones where like the acting's solid. Yeah, it could have been, at least the danger of it could have been emphasized more. In a way, it's almost interesting that they didn't try to have like a few more, like, I guess effectively red shirts around to just allow to show how dangerous it is by like other people that are also part of this leg of it or something that just kind of die off as we go along, or something like that, or even just like Well, I guess it is individuals. Otherwise, I'd say like crew members or something from the other people to really make them red shirts. But yeah, it's weird being reminded, yeah, that the Timeless Child stuff was effectively hinted at this early, when it doesn't get paid off until the end of the following series. I think we
gives good
we
evidence that
back...
Chibnall had planned everything out as a 3-season block.
Yeah, I mean, I remember us assuming like, oh, well, I guess that's what the series arc for this one was going to be, and then it never got paid off, and we were like, what the fuck? And then it did. But yeah, it's. I mean, it's also just generally interesting because this is one of the few actually leads off from the previous episode kind of episodes without it directly being a two-parter. Probably that New Who's like ever done. It's very rare. Like this felt, it felt very classic Who in that way, where like the final episode of one serial would usually be the opening of the next story. When they'd like replay kind of the first couple of minutes, the last couple of minutes or so from the end of the previous episode, when it was more serialized in that way. So this is like 60s Who that this feels reminiscent of. Yeah, I don't think I've got much else to say, just solid acting and all that. Not a bad episode in the slightest. That said, yeah, I, even though I gave it the same rating as Woman Who Fell to Earth, I'd probably put this as a B. It's like still kind of up there, but...
I'd rate this a B or a C. The story is an interesting one, and I like the idea of it, but it feels like it... Yeah, it doesn't feel like it moves fast enough to keep your interest. And furthermore, I remember this being an issue that a lot of the monsters seem to be knockoffs of video game creatures. They looked very, very, like, copy-paste. And I remember that just irking the hell out of me. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't
the only one.
I believe Randy also at the time was like, yeah, I feel like I've seen these before somewhere else. This is not Doctor Who monsters.
I forget if I brought it up in the podcast we covered this in, but after it, I bought a monster manual for D&D 5e and came across the... It's like Rug of Smothering or something like that. And it was like, oh, it's that. That's what Doctor Who was doing.
For that one scene, yeah. That I actually saw someone use that in a D&D campaign for... like a couple years before that came out, before that episode came out. So yeah, that is an interesting idea that maybe that they borrow something from that at least a little bit. I'm guessing since most everybody else is going to be, I guess we'll leave it at B for now.
Yep. All right. Next is Rosa.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of good here, which is why all the parts that are less than great frustrate me all the more.
Yeah.
Looking at it as edutainment, it's perfectly on par with what children are taught in school. That said, the Time Traveler is both a lackluster, though not absolutely terrible villain, and just a dishonest portrayal of what modern racism looks like, which is rarely so blatant and obvious. Because of that, I can't give this higher than an A. I know a lot of people feel like this is like top tier S level episode. The highest I could possibly give it is an A.
I mean, I think the only thing for me holding it off from being in the S is just the villain.
Yeah.
And it is funny that you say that like modern day racism isn't as blatant, and it's like.
I've seen some pretty blatant racism.
I feel like
racism.
A certain... Yeah, I was going to say,
it depends
on
where you're looking.
Presidency. feel like a certain presidency that was going on when this aired.
I don't know about that, but I would call out certain pockets like, on the internet. Just they are blatant, and it's just like, oh, hell no. I mean,
like, you could like you have certain people have the idea, oh, if I'm not saying slurs, I'm not racist, and that's kind of the mentality that I would almost think a kid could get from this episode. And
I give this episode, like, I think I remember one thing I liked about this episode was just that, like, previously when we've had people of color as companions, previously only all black, but now we've got Yaz, it was a matter of there'd be an episode where they'd be like, hey, we're in the past. Am I okay here? And it went from like nothing happened to Martha, except from being fetishized by Shakespeare. Bill copped some racist comments, but was like never in physical danger, at least not for racist reasons anyway. In here, Ryan gets slapped for daring to touch a white woman. And
not even
they're on the run
from
the cops. Trying to give her back a for like talking to her effectively. For trying to give her back like a handkerchief or something. And gets called the soft N-word for it. And there's like the whole thing of them assuming.
Might just get called the Spanish word for black.
Yeah. Well, that's what I mean by soft N, because like usually it's
I feel like I
dodgy.
Have to correct that, because there were people suing Crayola because the word Negro appeared, you know, saying that with an English accent, but the word Negro appeared on a black colored pencil, and people were like complaining to Crayola about it for being racist.
But yeah, which is, I mean, that's further than Doctor Who's gone before, really, is having like that kind of thing used. And it was like, it was interesting to actually have a story where you believed, yeah, they're actually in danger in this time period. Whereas previously they had just kind of shied away from that. But yeah, I think like, and I would have made this point back then, but this is one where like, if we weren't against returning villains for this series, I would have made this the Meddling Monk, and I would have made it a very depiction of, I don't realize, like, I don't necessarily think what I'm doing is racist kind of a portrayal, rather than the one they go for.
Yeah, I'm much more leaned towards the, so what if I change history a little bit? It's still going to come around in the end until they see the results of it going completely south.
And, like, this is a very
meddling
month.
Until the Doctor butts
month.
It and finally does something to fix it, yeah.
Yeah, and this just generally seems like a very meddling monk story.
It could have been, yeah.
I'm just going to nudge it a little bit because whatever. And, like, him not blatantly saying, oh, these, you know, whatever's blah, but it being more of a, oh, well, you know, they'll be fine, or like, oh, I change it this way because this will benefit me in the future somehow, because that's usually how he operates. So like that could have been interesting.
Yeah, it would change something in the future that he could profit from, but they have to undo it due to other reasons.
Yeah, for that. And yeah, mostly for the villain, because everything else, for the most part, I'm okay with. I would still drop this down to like an A, but I can't drop it any lower because I really like this one. And I gave this a 5 at the time, and I'm still dropping it down to an A.
I would have to agree with the most part for everyone that's commented here. I would really like the historical part, and if it would have stayed a pure historical, it would have actually been really good to see where they would have gone with it and kept it a pure historical. But the inclusion of a random guy from the future who's basically a useless idiot just kind of like makes you go, how did this guy even get time travel in the first place? Highly unlikely, highly unrealistic, and just kind of sours the entire intent of the episode altogether. So I can't hate on it too hard, but I will say that they needed some fixing up. They didn't do the sci-fi element any justice in this one, so it's only an A. So, Arachnids in the UK. Bill? Did Bill go AFK?
He had to be LB and just said it in text. So, well, I'll just go to mine. I feel like this is one where rewatching it, I kind of soured on it a bit. Not much. Like, it's not that it, like, completely flipped around to, oh, I hate this now. But it was just like, eh, I don't know. Like, as much as I like this in the moment, and, like, I still like it to a point. But I feel like this is one that's dragged down by them leaning a bit too much into the modern Who stance of, no, the Doctor just doesn't like killing at all, even when it's necessary. No. And it's like, because there's a whole shit with that giant spider that is effectively suffocating anyway. And, like, I get, like, you know, fuck the Trump stand-in, but also, it's a lot more, in that moment, it's kind of a lot more humane to just shoot it and put it out of its misery than be like, no, we have to suffocate them all. It's like, that's a lot more brutal. So it's just weird that the Doctor's like, no, 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 we're not going to give them a quick death, which would be humane. We're going to give them, you know, a long, arduous, suffocating death. Like,
are you talking about the one spider or just in general?
In general, but also it's just that one. The one with the giant spider.
I was
going to
say, the one giant spider that he shot, you could argue because he didn't ask, he didn't care. And, like, that might be it. But by the way, if no one said anything, well, since I just got back, hello, our one member of chat, Hunter. I'll just say Hunter.
We had somebody in chat. Mm. Hello.
Yep.
Mm.
I really pushed this episode, so I was hoping we'd get a couple of chatters.
The main thing that I found interesting watching this the first time through was that this is effectively like a redo, like a modern take on the Green Death from the Pertwee era. Just with giant spiders instead of giant, like, maggots and flies and stuff. and no, like, evil robot thing in it either. I feel like this is, but as I said, I feel like this has slid down, like, a bit compared to when I first watched it. So, for me,
that's funny, my score went up, your score went down.
Yeah. So, yeah, for me, this is a B.
A B, okay. All right. So now that you're finally back,
yes. I said my notes, this episode is perfect B-movie schlock. It could be a movie, if not for the fact that it's Trump XB would be considered too on the nose for a movie. Funnily enough, I penalized this episode initially for toning down the Trump XB, because why bother to include him if you're only going to go halfway? That said, this episode shines as an episode about family in particular, and I would probably give this a low A.
Whereas Alex is slow,
which basically makes Matt the tiebreaker.
Yeah, whereas Alex is sliding into A, B, and Bill is just plain simple A, I'm still in the S, A tier. I think this is a, like, return to campy Monster of the Week form and some of the best stuff of it. And honestly, they did a better job of this than they did of most of anything else that season. It's the closest to possibly reaching S that we have here, but since everyone else is basically in agreement of the at least somewhere in A, I guess this is just going to land in A. A lot
by the way,
all
four of these episodes were 4.5 or 4.6 the first time we went through. Granted, that is slightly inflated by having Tim on the panel. Mm. Very slightly, though. Because
Tim.
I was the low one with this episode for 3.5, but we had three people rated a 5 out of 5, so it balanced out. And now I'm rating higher than that. All right, the Suranga Conundrum. So this is the first episode after the initial arc, right after they've agreed to stay on the TARDIS. While we saw things be slow early on, this is where we see issues of telling instead of showing and setting things up without paying it off. I really can't give this story higher than a B.
I'm trying to remember which one this was. I have to look at my list now.
This is the one with the tiny alien that eats.
Yep.
Yeah, that eats like everything. Well, I say everything. It eats technology.
Mm-hmm.
It eats things that can give it power.
This is the one where Graham and Ryan are the doulas for a man who's giving birth.
Mm.
That might stand out in your memory.
the little thing that the guy who's going to be giving birth, and then the little thing just escapes and starts eating up just about everything.
Yep.
Yeah. And I remember us joking at the time that this was one of those. Oh, so that's where the budget for this series went. Because the Bating looked amazing for Doctor Who. Like, it was like, holy shit. So it's like, oh, that's where the money went. They just, either that or whoever was animating this was like, nah, fuck this. I'm going to make this look great. But yeah, like, it's so funny because this really is that one episode where, you know, I gave this a 4, seemingly. If I can.
Yes, you were one of the highballers for this one with a 4.
Yeah. But even then, I feel like that absolutely was the ceiling for me. Of like, there was no way this was going to get any higher than that. Because, like, as much as there are for me, I like, especially having rewatched it all these years later, there's a ceiling that it just hits and it just can't get past because in hindsight, this is a fair, like in the moment, I think it's good, but it's ultimately can be very forgettable in the grand scheme. I mean, we literally had Matt had to be like, wait, what was this episode?
Yeah. I had to try to remember which one this was because I don't remember it by name.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a relatively sharp drop in quality compared to the 4 that came before it.
Mm.
Like not as sharp as some drops in quality are, but yeah.
Yeah. Like, there are bits and pieces that are nice, and it's one of those, like, something happens to the sonic screwdriver so the doctor can't use it to...
Bating eats it.
Yeah. So it's like, oh, crap, now I've got to think instead of waving my magic wand. But yeah, there is definitely a ceiling on it, and even with all the acting being good and some of the interesting things that happen, I do think that the highest this can go is B.
Yeah, basically, I'm going to have to agree with that. Great visual effects of the monster. Honestly, interesting story, and good acting, but it's just like the story was mostly just people running around in a panic. And then we have to have an excuse to sacrifice somebody so that at least somebody dies and there's stakes to the story.
Yep.
It starts off really well and ends really well, but the in-between is very kind of meh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a lot of... It's almost kind of like the kind of meme that is usually shows up in, like... Oh, I say meme. It's like a trope where it's like... list of bad stuff and the promise tomorrow, except for instead of and the promise tomorrow, it's and the baby's coming.
All right, next one we have Demons of the Punjab. This episode is very similar to Rozo with one key difference. While the true villain in both stories is within the era they live in, Rozo required a time traveler to be part of it for the problem to exist, while Demons of the Punjab did not. While an argument can be made for Rozo needing to be a pseudo-historical, there's no such argument for Demons of the Punjab, which could have just been a true historical. I guess that makes this technically worse due to the unnecessary sci-fi elements, placing this in between B and A tiers. Also, another chatter, Ayushu, hello.
This is S for me. This is my first, and it may end up being my only.
So I said A or B, and you said S. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Like this,
which actually, yeah, that matches up exactly with your rating from the first time. Yeah. So no surprise there.
Yeah. This was a 5 for me, and my opinion did not budge on this rewatch. It was, I love Demons of the Punjab. Like, I was very much of the mind as well that, like, this should have just been a pure historical. But even watching it back, I can't fault it too much for the alien involvement. Even so far as, like, it's at least a nice twist on you think the aliens are the bad guys, but it turns out, no.
Yeah,
they're actually here for good guy reasons.
These are rankings of Doctor Who episodes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, ranking all the...
these are episodes, yes. They're asking if these are movie rankings. These are episode rankings for the entirety of the Chibnall / Jodie Whittaker run. We've done something similar before, but we've never done it in this format before.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, like, this was... I remember at the time, I think this episode almost made me cry. And watching it back, the ending almost made me cry again. Also, extra points for ending on a sad note and then not just kicking back into the normal credits theme. Because I fucking hate when shows do that. And Doctor Who is guilty of doing that before. I mean, with Adric, they just had no music and that was effective.
Right.
But there have been episodes of Doctor Who that end on a somber note, but then they're just... And it's like, that's too jarring. Whereas this has a very sort of haunting... I don't know exactly what... like, that part of the world kind of focused cover of the theme, which I don't think I picked up the first time, or it's just it's been so long.
Oh, like a Punjabi style theme.
Yeah, like cover of the theme, which was like, oh, that's actually very nice. And it fits the tone that we're going with and all that, and just yes. Like, really the only thing that I have that is the negative is just the fact that this could have been a pure historical. But even then, to me, this is still an S. It is the... Having seen, now that the era is definitively over, this is the best episode, at least to me. Again, there is a bunch that I didn't get to rewatch. But to me, this is the best thing to come out of the Chibnall era.
All right, Matt?
I'm glad you really like this episode, but I just know. I'm agreeing with Bill. It's at best a B. It feels like it's just.
Oh, that's
Rozo.
Not agreeing with. I said between B and A, but.
Well, I'm saying that I'm agreeing with the idea of it being around a B because it feels like a Rozo rehashed, And once again, even more so than Rosa, it feels like the aliens are kind of pointless in this, and it's no reason for them to be here. This just could have been pure historical, and it could have been, like, marginally improved by being just that. And it's just, nah. But I'm
so I guess the middle ground consensus would be
the middle consensus would be an A. So I'm gonna have to toss it there. But I just I'm not really a fan of this. It feels like a rehash of the exact same episode we had two episodes ago.
I mean, it's in terms of the history it covers, it's a very different part of the world, but it's very similar in terms of like themes and such.
Messaging,
I might not have put it in the same season if it were up to me.
Or at the very least, very different halves of the season.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but at least not two episodes apart, right? Or three episodes apart.
Only two episodes apart. It was like one, two, and it's back again. Anyways, kablam. Right.
Yep, kablam. Kablam is a solid story. It upends the traditional approach by having neither of the obvious culprits be guilty and having local knowledge be the true culprit. The biggest sin this episode commits is having Amazon be the good guy. Still, I think this story is worth an A.
Now, this is where we get to the hard part, because I did not get to rewatch Kablam.
I can't remember a lot of the interplay. I just remember I was fine with the ending, and then a lot of people seemed really against it. I'm like, okay.
Yeah, like I honestly don't even think I necessarily my brain like kicked in to realize what they were really doing until it was pointed out, and then I was like, oh right, yeah, we are kind of doing capitalism is good actually. Without like, and I doubt that's what they meant, and I think that's what makes it kind of worse, is that I doubt they actually meant to have that message.
The real message was really like, it was basically that like automation is neither good nor bad was the real message.
Yeah. But it's like, wow, this stand in for Amazon is absolutely great and not evil at all. It's just this one technical issue that's the problem. And actually it's this one freedom fighter that's like actually the bad guy. And it's like, there is a way, and I think even something I remember watching is like, there's a way to do that and make it work that doesn't just feel like we're kissing this corporation's ass.
Mm-hmm.
But they didn't do that. So it feels like fumbled, like interesting idea, fumbled execution kind of a thing.
Right. And I'm trying to hold myself back from adding to that because I don't want every episode to be a 5-minute discussion.
So. Yeah.
It was some guy that basically was undermining the company, trying to undermine the company, and blamed for the thing that was happening. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Highest I can give this without a rewatch is a B.
Okay, B.
Honestly, so as I'm recalling, it was kind of closer to an A for me. I was okay with this one.
Funnily enough, you actually rated it lower than both of us at the time.
Yeah.
Only slightly.
I have to revisit that episode then. Apparently, I'm having mixed signals at the moment.
You and Alex basically switched ratings.
So you're at a B. I'm at A, I guess. And Bill, you were at.
Yeah, so we have A and B. So I guess it averages out to a low B. Right. I mean, a low A.
A low A, yeah.
Yep.
A lot of A's in this. The Witchfinders?
Witchfinders is next, yep. This is the third pseudo-historical of the Chibnall era, and in my opinion, the first one that properly nails the pseudo-historical format. The sci-fi entity and the historical setting are both equally causes of the problem. They both needed to be resolved together to fix the problem. Yaz goes off on her own and gets some character development, or at least some history, which has been our big criticism of the season, and a criticism that's made a little better in retrospect when, there's actually enough of Yaz's character for her to have been bullied about, which we don't know what she was bullied for when this episode came out. So for me, this is the S historical.
I know I can't give it as high as an S as well, so I'm going to have to disagree on
that.
But mainly,
this with no S's?
Yeah, mainly because the thing that pissed me off about this story, and like, I rated this kind of high. I gave this like a 4.5.
Yeah.
But I think that a lot of that was acting and like three quarters of the episode. But then we get into the sci-fi stuff, and I'm like, this feels so tacked on. This feels like, well, we've got to have a monster of the week.
Oh, so the exact opposite
so we'll
of what I
this.
Just said is what you feel.
Yeah. And I feel like we had that, like, a lot of us, at least at the time, had that same, we're like, at least some of us were kind of agreed on that as, like, it just kind of felt kind of phoned in to have the sci-fi element when this absolutely could have just been a pure historical. I mean, it's a thing about witch burnings and we've got a female doctor. I mean, come on. So, you know, it was a fairly strong episode otherwise, but it was one of those episodes where like, okay, you've got me, got me, got me. Oh, now you lost me. And even then, it's not like a gigantic dip. But yeah, I feel like the highest I could probably go for. And again, this is another one that I didn't get to rewatch. Everything from here on, I didn't get to rewatch. But I would say highest I could probably give this is an A. Because, like, it drops, but not, again, doesn't drop an astronomical amount.
I'd have to agree. I'm thinking about the A section as well. As far as I can remember, I liked it a lot, but not like it blew me away. It was just pretty decent. It was better than some of the other previous stuff that had happened recently. It's basically what I can remember of it.
All right.
So
that's
we're landing
another A average. Yep.
It takes you
away. All right,
away.
Next is It Takes You Away. When we first watched this episode, we were reeling from the frog at the end. Watching this episode later, all I see is a poignant story about grief. It may seem a cop-out after so many A's this season, but I think It Takes You Away could also fall in the A category.
In hindsight, I'm surprised. Like, again, even without rewatching this, I forget why I did not give this a 5. I'd have to rewatch it before I would
probably
even
the
think
frog.
About changing.
That was the main thing we talked about.
It. I remember me and Tim being the two that were championing that. Me and Tim were both keen on that element. And it
was
mainly
was
everyone else.
Basically,
it was a personification of that pocket universe.
Yeah, it was like the sentient universe, like, found out that Grace likes frogs and decided, I think I'm going to become a frog too.
Like, I forget what I saw some people compare it to. If it was either people were saying that it felt very Douglas Adams, or it felt very...
Maybe.
Actually, yeah, it probably would have been Douglas Adams.
Uh-huh.
That I think Ish, people yeah. Either that or Terry Pratchett. Were people comparing that to a very... I could see that them doing this. Or something like
one of these days, I need to just sit down with a bunch of Terry Pratchett books.
Yeah, I remember really enjoying this. Something tells me if anything brought it down, it was the stuff in that in-between space. Like those dark corridors with those like flesh-eating bugs or whatever was probably the thing that was like, did we really need that bit? Could we have just not made this like pretty much all about grief? Because that's what this is like, it's
yeah.
A story mostly revolving around grief and being able to let go. Like, this is effectively when like the turning point of Graham having that moment of I have to let you go so I can live my life. It's like, you're always going to be with me, but I have to like stop wallowing in grief.
Right.
It's harder because it's like, I feel like there's maybe just enough to hold it back to A, but part of me wants to give it an S anyway. But yeah, I'd say A is probably the highest it can go, just because there are some elements that I'm like, did we really need that?
So basically everyone's going A already.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think yeah, there are some elements that would almost make me lean towards B, but the majority of it does leave me leaning into an A position for it as well. But yeah, the weird in between in the dark corridors seemed very unnecessary and honestly also very cheaply made. But the rest of it actually seemed like interesting ideas that they could have followed up on, but of course, Chibnall being Chibnall. When does he follow up on anything? Speaking of the only time he followed up on anything.
I mean, he followed up on the timeless child. You just didn't like it.
Yes, let's follow up on the most hated thing we've done to the show. That's a
But
smart
it wouldn't have been
idea.
there yet. The Battle of Ranskor Av Kolos. So this episode was very ambitious, and I'm a little surprised looking back that we all rated it so highly, just because it almost feels like it's trying to do too much. After a season in which themes of loss and grief were extremely prevalent, it's fitting that this episode focused on themes of revenge and punishment, an A episode to cap off an A season.
Alex?
Something tells me, thinking about it in hindsight without having rewatched it, that we rated it so high just because the acting was strong, rather than, like, it's one of those ones where the acting negates a lot of the problems we have with the writing. Because thinking back on it, this is very like, ultimately kind of, again, without having rewatched it, so my mind isn't as fresh, but a very weird finale. I mean, it's another one of those ones where, like, well, if the Doctor doesn't, stop the villain, Earth is going to be destroyed, as are a ton of other planets. And there's the whole thing with the commentary on religion to a point going on. And all that, and like the constant, oh, is Graham gonna kill the villain from episode one to get revenge for Grace? And like most he does is accidentally shoot him in the foot. It's either shot him in the foot or shot him in the shoulder, I forget which.
The foot, I
Non-lethally,
think.
anyway.
Unlawfully harmed him a little.
And it was like, oh shit, no, I didn't mean to do that. Don't tell the doctor.
I think it was like, yeah, it was like to throw him off so he didn't shoot them or something.
But yeah, it's one of those ones where, like, at first I was almost thinking of ranking it much lower, but I don't. It without having rewatched it, it's a bit hard to figure where to place it. But I think I'll just go B because it feels, in hindsight, fairly unremarkable in that it's very, like, kind of a bog standard end of series episode, but also just like, I think some things that bug me were also just like the constant no shooting, no guns, no killing crap from the doctor is just like ramped way up, and I'm just like, oh, shut up.
And I think
Like,
that
I've
was
got
even
like
only actually one scene, and then they talked about it in
probably,
her absence when she wasn't there.
Like, it was nice that Graham like comes to the decision himself when given the opportunity to not do it, and it feels more like, well, the doctor told me I can't, so I'm not going to. It's just a matter of, okay, no, I as a person with agency have made the choice to not. Yeah, without having rewatched it and the score I gave it, I will tentatively give it an A.
Can I just say that's a super ambitious plot to give the comic relief character.
Right.
Yeah. Maybe, and like, and really, that might be why I gave it a score as high as I did, because it was like he was just acting his ass off the whole episode.
I mean, the whole main crew was for that episode.
Yeah.
So it's been A and an A.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I would have given this like low S, high A, because it finally is like decent closure for a lot of stuff in this particular episode. And I would have actually been happy with half the crew already leaving at that point at the end of this episode permanently. And this is, I believe, the season closer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I also had
the main battle of the first episode come back, final episode, but it wasn't. Mm-hmm.
I also had the main battle of the first episode come back and do a closer for that character permanently as well. It was like a nice self-contained thing. Matter of fact, I would have been actually happier if the first episode and the last episode were the only episodes. That would have been just S tier across the board and done. A lot of the in-between was not necessary. But yeah, I'll... since we're basically right there anyways, I guess it's a mostly A season. So,
yep.
Resolution.
All right, yeah, so resolution. So I'd say this is great as a piece of sci-fi. Daleks as the puppet masters is a great way to make the squid side of a Dalek far more intimidating than it was in the past. The plot with Ryan's father doesn't quite live up to the rest of the episode, although it might have if we ever actually saw him again. So I'd say high B.
Alex.
I'm willing to give this an A, and I think that mostly comes down to a lot of the acting, and just the idea of, okay, cool, we're doing the sort of one Dalek being very dangerous over again, but a different look and different settings, so rather than an enclosed space, this is a Dalek that's able to roam the countryside.
A Dalek fix itself up on its own with limited resources, Dalek, on the run in public, yeah.
This is I remember a sticking point I had, is that if they were going to write Graham out, and I'm, you know, I appreciate, and we'll get to it later anyway, but I appreciate that he exited how he exited ultimately. But if we were going to have a companion death, and I mean like a full on, they die, no fucking Moffat shit around it, death, that Graham sacrificing himself to kick that Dalek out of the TARDIS would have been great as a send-off for that character, and kind of would mirror how Grace died. So it would be able to be like, you know, she did this to protect people. I'm going to, you know, try and live up to that and go out in a similar way. In hindsight, I almost kind of would have liked that by virtue of the fact that I love Graham as a companion, but three companions was too much. I almost feel like it would have been better if it was three, then two, then one. So like Yaz had stuck through the whole thing, Ryan had left after series 12, and Graham had just had this one series, and then the special, and that's it. Alternatively, him just actively deciding to leave the TARDIS after the fact, after the end of the story, to be like, okay, I need to move on with my life now, blah, blah, blah. That would have been a really good ending too. I can't ultimately otherwise fault it too much. Without having rewatched it, so I'm gonna give this this falls in an A for me.
Okay. Yeah, I'm gonna say this is also probably gonna be once again final A. I really like the Dalek in this one. It would have been nice again to have some follow up of Ryan's dad, but of course, as we mentioned, no follow up at all, which that could have been possibly something that could have pushed it a little bit higher in hindsight. Mm-hmm. But I guess it is what it is for some of that stuff.
Yeah, originally I gave it a 4.5, but I'm like, the Ryan's dad stuff coupled with the fact that we never saw him again ended up bringing it down on a rewatch.
And to that end, I think we even discussed at the time that, and it probably rings a bit thingoer now, that if that was basically going to be the end of Ryan's dad showing up, then in a way, him sacrificing himself.
Yeah, that came up a lot during the podcast, during the original review.
Yeah. Could have been like, yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, we may want to speed up a little bit since we're almost at 90 minutes.
Yeah.
All right, where the hell did I just scroll to? Okay, Spyfall Part 1. This episode is amazing. It sets up the two-parter. It sets up the season. But it also has its own beginning, middle, and end with mystery, stakes, and conclusions. Easy S tier for me.
Yeah, if we... Given that we're doing these separately, I would say S tier for part one. Like, it is the only reason it got the story overall, got the rating it got, is that part two kind of brought things down a bit. But yeah, Spyfall 1 is great.
So Spyfall 1, S tier, well. Everyone agrees S tier, Spyfall 1?
Yeah.
Yep.
Hear, hear. That was amazing. It was an amazing spy story in and of itself. And the fact that they have a little bit of a Doctor Who twist on it was fantastic. I loved it. I was very hopeful. And now for the sinker, Spyfall Part 2.
Part 2. Not as good as Part 1, but still pretty good. Heavy on the edutainment, but not in a boring way. I only wish we got to see more of Ada and Noor, although they each had a moment of companion-worthy action. I put it on the edge between A and S tier, though it sounds like Matt disagrees already.
Yeah, I would... I feel like... I was hoping going into this episode when we initially covered it that it would be still good enough for me to give it the overall story a 5, but given that I only seem to have given it a 4... I think that says that, at least for me, that dragged it down somewhat, but not like a hell of a lot, because it could have dropped it down even further if it was really crap. But like, the part one's doing a lot of heavy lifting, but I would say part two at least goes down to an A for me.
I should add, this is one of two episodes in which the 13th Doctor weaponizes somebody else's racism against her enemies, and I mainly partially bring that up because I've seen a few people on Twitter like basically saying that's why they really hate this episode, so that might have lowered our group score initially. I honestly don't remember.
Possibly, because the reason that happened is because the Doctor managed to lower the whatever field on the Master who was hiding what he was in front of the Nazis.
The Master was pretending to look like a German, and then the Doctor used that to help herself escape.
Which I am not against, because she knows the Master's going to escape eventually anyways.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way Germans are going to be, especially World War II Germans, are going to be smart enough or strong enough to stop the Master. The Master has plans within plans.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If the Master didn't get away from that, he's not the Master.
Yeah.
He can play them better than a Cyberman. Mm. I will say I was hoping when episode 2 was coming out that we get more of episode 1. Very harshly disappointed on that.
Yeah, very different episode. Very different.
Very different episode, but I will say for the episode it wasn't terrible. That waits until the next one. So I will say it's like the BA range. I wish it could have been better, but it could have been a whole lot worse. And everyone else is basically A range, so I guess it's A.
Yeah.
So, Orphan 55.
Yeah, Orphan 55. So, the ending of this episode kind of dominates the actual story in people's memories. The actual story is kind of middle of the road, arguably decent. There's a parenthood plot, but it's not executed as well as it could have been. Taking the whole package, I'd say a B.
Funnily enough, I was the most positive on this, I remember, but that was mainly because the twist didn't bug me as much. I just kind of laughed it off. But funnily enough...
Yeah, the twist didn't bother me. It was the scene in the TARDIS afterward that bothered me.
Oh, right. Yeah. And, like, that didn't bother me as much either. I still only ranked at, like, 3.5 or something. So I was still like, oh, I'm not going to, like, put my neck on the line for this story by any stretch. But, like, it didn't bug you as much as anyone else. That being said, actually going with, like, the story, and again, having not rewatched this since we covered initially, I would probably have it be the first to go lower than that, and I would actually give it, put it in like the C or D range.
Ooh.
Okay, C or D for Alex. Matt.
Welcome to my cave, Alex. The first half of this episode was really good. Really good. They did an amazing job with the special effects they had. They did some really decent character acting and some other side stories. And then the last half of the episode just wasted all the potential. They gave it a plot twist that was stupid. They dragged the bad guys out into the blazing bright light, dimmed to gray, and made them look really cheesy, hokey, and ugly, and just ineffective. And then, at the very end of the episode, the doctor shouts at the audience to stop being assholes. I got a better idea for you, writer. You stop being an asshole. I'm in the FD range with this one. So, maybe push it up to C?
I was going to say, yeah, that sounds like a high D, low C is the average.
So, yeah, just barely pushing that up to C. That's a basement dweller for me. Fuck that writer in particular for forcing that
right,
on the screen.
All right, next is Nikola Tesla's Night of Terror. Despite the terrible name, this is an episode that manages to be decent history edutainment, which is clearly the strength of this production team, and also decent sci-fi, A for me.
Yeah, I remember this being fairly solid. I don't think we had... I think this was one of those stories where, like, the reasons the scores only capped at, like, 4, I don't think anyone went higher than that.
There are 2 4.5s.
Okay.
Neither of them are people who are currently with us.
Right. But I'm in a way, I'm not surprised it never got to a 5. But insofar as... it's one of those stories that it's really solid, but there's like, it's just missing that thing that pushes it all the way up. So yeah, I'd say it's a solid A.
I'm in the AB range, so I'm guessing this is going to land in an A at this point.
Yeah.
I feel
if you're ranking them, that would be a lower A if it's AAB or, you know, well, yeah.
The lower range A. Everyone's on A, basically.
Yep.
I feel like the edutainment part of it was really good. I feel like some of the effects and actually a returning side character as a different character in this episode, wink, wink, was also a nice touch. But I felt there were certain moments that undermined a lot of what was going on with characters, which does still irritate me. Apparently, Yaz is no good at being a police officer in the past. For reasons. Shrug. Which was really, really, really badly written, in my opinion. So, stuff like that kind of still irked me. But overall, it's not a terrible episode. Just kind of a turn your mind off and enjoy the ride episode.
Right. This episode is almost entirely set up for the last 4 episodes of the season, combined with some fan service. Taken on its own, though, the mystery is pretty interesting, and that's executed well. With the Time Lords being suitably impressive, or I guess the Division being suitably impressive, and the two Doctors playing off one another well, I'd say between B and A.
Yeah, I'm falling into that category as well. It's one of those things where this is one where it's kind of permanently stained by what comes after. Because this was one where I gave it like a tentative... I think originally I gave it a 4.5 with the idea that if the payoff didn't live up to expectation, that I would bring it down, and I did. So it's one of those ones where it's hard to really think about in isolation because it is set up.
It's also permanently stained by the fact that after this episode came out is around a time we found out that John Barrowman still couldn't stop whipping it out on TV sets.
Yeah. Yeah. Was it then or was it after?
It was somewhere in that range.
It was somewhere around that time, yeah.
Mm. Yeah. So...
because him coming back got the gossip mongers stirring again.
Mm.
I think it was that episode. Actually, no. I think it actually might have came a little bit later. I think it might have been... which one
it was
it?
After his next appearance is when it's basically just like... is when he basically went on his "fuck you, I'm not apologizing for anything" tour.
Mm. I'm trying to remember which one that was. It was the one where they do the prison break, but I can't remember what episode it was called.
Yeah, that was
Revolution of the Cybermen. Yeah. I mean, of the Daleks. Why I'm not saying
Revolution of the Daleks. Okay, so yeah. Yeah, after that. I think there were some whispers of it at the time, but it was definitely around then that everything just spiked to an all new high, and they basically he's basically been shadow banned.
I guess if nothing else, a lot of the acting in that is still good enough in this that I would at least say like high B.
I forget the actress name. I should know it off the top of my head. Ruth was perfectly acted. Yes. Jo Martin, exactly.
Again, I
what rating did you just say?
B.
B.
Okay.
And I have to agree with the motion for B, because while I do agree that Jo Martin was a really good actress for a possible tentative Doctor at some point, a lot of the future events ruined that for me. There was so much going for this episode, and then like everything tied to it became a huge letdown, either in real world BSery or in just the show dropping it like a hot potato. For no good reason, and just not doing anything proper with it. So with that, it's a high B, low A.
Yep.
We're leaving in the B range because there's way too many A's. Phyrexus.
Phyrexus. So, like I said when this came out, this episode is literally Birdemic. While some episodes before this could be accused of sacrificing the story for the sake of delivering a message in a way people are not going to listen to, Praxeus leans super far into this with a story that just doesn't live up. C tier. No hesitation on C tier on that one for me.
Alex?
I mean, the main thing I remember about this story is it feeling very... and like we would have even said this at the time, is that this was effectively Orphan 55 done right.
And even then, it's not done very well.
Or at least done better. And of course, it's funny because I remember the one hang up I had was that this would have been really fun if the villain had turned out to be the Rani, because this was like the perfect scenario to bring her back if you were going to, by virtue of it being, here's this sciencey shit gone wrong. And like as soon as that,
and it could be the Rani doing horrible experiments on things on Earth, and that would be just perfect and up her alley.
Yeah. And like it didn't like absolutely kill the episode for me that it wasn't, but it was just like, damn. But yeah, I feel like I definitely can't rate this too highly, but I think I can be a little nicer than a C, so for me it falls around B. Like lower lower than everything that's in there at the moment, probably.
I maybe hate about to three. Be the one to burst your bubble. I'm like CD range on this one. I felt it was, it could be at times very interesting, but then it just got overwhelmed with being too preachy and too pretentious and up its own behind. All the good stuff is just becomes wasted potential, and it just becomes a, can we be over now? Kind of moment. So with that, I guess it lands at a C.
Yeah.
Plunk.
All right. Can you hear me? Yeah, this is a weird episode, which makes it hard to rate. Go to therapy is not necessarily a bad message, but it kind of seems to override the story in this case. I put this in like B minus, low B tier.
Yeah, for me, it's either A or B, and it's one of those things. If I remember at the time saying that this felt almost like it needed a part two, but not in the episode length new Who episodes currently are. Like, if, and like, I think I've argued before, like, if this was like Sarah Jane Adventures, where it was split in two, but half hour episodes each, that would have maybe worked because you could fuck around with the pacing. But like,
Chibnall kind of introduced like getting rid of the 45 minute limit and just being,
yeah,
kind of
as long
different
as it
lengths
to be kind of a thing. Yeah, because it felt like it needed a bit more, but not like,
which,
a
by the
full...
way, that made it hard to binge this.
yeah. But yeah, I'm falling somewhere in A B. Like, high B, low A.
Hey, Matt?
I'm much lower on the totem pole on this one, as I recall. I recall this being a complete and total letdown. This could have been something far more interesting, and it even started off as something very interesting, and then it just kind of felt, once again, like a bunch of wasted potential that went nowhere and did nothing and just became a bottlenecked episode with the Doctor being the only main character on for the most time for this episode. Yeah, just kind of really just a meh to me. This could be more interesting, and it just also kind of lent me to believe that they just took the ideas of other previous big bads and made them really boring. So I'm much more like a C grade on this one. So I guess this, okay. Were you two, A and B?
So I said low, yeah. B, Alex said B, A, and then you said C. So I guess B would be
the average.
Average, yeah.
For that, yep.
All right. The Haunting of Via Diodati. So I'm a little disappointed in this story because it successfully leans into Haunted House and Frankenstein, despite the lesson of the story being Percy Shelley. Our original review of the episode, when we did the historical fact check, was the first time I even learned that Percy Shelley was a poet. And I really don't think they set up his historical importance properly for how important that was for the climax. And as a result of that, that puts this somewhere between C and B tier for me.
Which is kind of interesting in hindsight, because on the first go around... Oh, no, wait, yeah, no. I was looking at the...
I was the low ball the first
ratings
time.
Ratings wrong, yeah. You were low ball, and Matt was the high ball for this one.
I still am.
Not thinking, like, again, having not rewatched it that much, I think this is one that had we rated this with what came after, it would have dragged it down more.
Oh yeah.
But at the time, I remember enjoying this a decent amount. I mean, there's would have been a reason that it didn't go higher than I gave it, but I would I'd say low A, high B again for that one.
Oh, if it was just this episode by itself, nothing else tied, it could easily be S tier for me. I was so happy with this episode, so thoroughly entertained by it, and just everything else the attached existence to this of a shot fumbles the ball. Everything else just shoots this poor thing in the foot and makes me just limp along. So it sadly has to be pushed down to at least A tier for me. Maybe almost B because of just how badly everything gets affected afterwards.
So that would make the average between the three of us a B.
So, yeah, A, B, and an A?
C, B, B, A, B, A.
Oh.
Or, yeah. Or,
actually, yeah, they'll be kind of a B. Everyone agrees on B.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right, and I know, well, the next two episodes, there's going to be some disagreement, but let's try to keep the talk about it to very short. Ascension of the Cybermen, a proper war story with the Cybermen. The human story here is great, although Ashad could definitely have used more characterization. The Brendan plot really doesn't add anything either to this episode or to the duology, which brings it down, but I'd still think this episode itself is probably A tier.
Yeah, I remember most of the issues we had were mostly
originally
just
we rated it as a two-parter. Yeah.
Yeah, and I remember most of what dragged it down was the episode that comes after it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I'm going to.
And even then, Matt and Ran were the only ones that rated it below a three.
Did I rate this one below a three?
Yeah.
You gave it a two.
You gave it a two, while Alex, Tim, and I all gave it a four for the two-parter.
Man, I must have really hated this one.
You really hated the second part.
Yeah, actually, did we rate the two-parter as a whole
thing? Yeah, we did it as a two-parter before. We're rating it separately now.
Okay, so rating this, without it being a two-parter tied together, rating it as separate, this is maybe an A-B for me. It's got definitely some really good parts to it, but you can start to feel like there's some cracks showing.
Hmm.
For me. So I guess we're letting this one an A then?
Yep.
What did Alex say?
Yeah, I said A.
Yeah.
You said A? Okay.
So the timeless
so that would make it an A. Yep.
Children.
The timeless children. This is going to be harder to average. In some ways, this episode is a love letter to the history of Doctor Who, but it definitely wasn't received that way. On one hand, we get the Morbius Doctors, the Matrix, the 70s Cybermen, and the three founders. On the other hand, we get the destruction of Gallifrey and at least a full regeneration cycle pre-Hartnell. However, I think it was well done. Maybe A tier, but I'm not as confident as I was with the previous episode. And this episode would be better if the Brendan plot had ever returned, like the next time Tectaeon appears. But since it doesn't, that definitely key. I mean, I don't think it was going to be S by the time all three of us voted anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, for me, this is like, I would say B. I mean, I was nicer. I remember being more positive on this than most everyone else at the time that we originally covered this. And I think that's just because I resigned myself to an idea in the same vein of the timeless child was kind of inevitable. So that it was more of a, oh, okay, yeah, this was bound to happen at some point, rather than being able to really get angry about it. But aside from that, I think I was fairly positive on this just because it was one of those things where it was brought up by the acting. So for me, the absolute lowest I could go for this is like a high B.
All right, Matt.
We're waiting for you to call. F tier. I despise this episode with every fiber of my being as a fan of this franchise. What I witnessed in this episode was a betrayal of everything that was the history of Doctor Who. On top of that, we got a bunch of bullshit flying around, including turning Time Lords into Cybermen. I'm sorry, didn't we at one point kind of discuss that trying to do something like that would essentially make the Cyberman implants essentially explode and make the attempt null and mutant point? It, like, flies in the face of its own history in multiple levels, including basically effing up the Doctor's history, which I still don't believe in. I still believe that what we saw here was the Matrix lying about everything, and there must have been some normal humans on Gallifrey or something, because there's no effing way you can take people who are going to explode on death and shove them into mechanical parts and expect it to stay that way. There's no way. And even then, even if they somehow managed to do it, the cybernetic implants wouldn't be able to handle a cyber Time Lord brain, which would again still cause it to somehow malfunction, go crazy, and explode. There's just so much flying in the face of what is the past of this franchise that I just know. Mm-mm. All of my hate on so many levels.
So that averages out, if once I convert them to numbers, into a C.
Which is what I kind of thought it would turn out to be, but...
Yep.
If there was a chance we could actually rate something a zero, I would.
Right, so I'll read my notes for the next episode, and then I'm going to go grab a bottle of water. Which, I mean, I'll only be there for 30 seconds. But Revolution of the Daleks. This is a direct sequel to at least three different episodes, some of which were direct sequels to one another, which makes this one of the most set-up Doctor Who episodes of all time. And I could see this one in S tier.
Hmm. Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that at the time this aired, we were kind of like, this might be the best thing for Doctor Who itself, at least. Because you could maybe make an argument for Countryside being better, but that's Torchwood. The best, like, Doctor Who specific thing at the time he had written. And I would definitely say it's still one of the best things. And I, like, you know, I was shouting it from the rooftops back then. But the main thing I loved about this is that companions were allowed to leave. Instead of this constant bullshit of being forced out of the TARDIS. I hate it. I'm over it. I'm glad that we've had it a break from it for as long as we have. Because it's been nice to have a string of companions. Even when RTD brought Donna back, she was allowed to just leave the TARDIS. And it's like, oh,
Yaz
thank
was
God,
forced
can we keep
out of the TARDIS
going?
Kind of.
Well, that was more nudged.
Mm-hmm.
That was very Sarah Jane kind of thing, where it's like, I need to do this alone kind of a thing. But yeah, I could definitely see this in either S or at least a high A.
I can't even remember. What did I review this?
You were the low ball with a 4.0.
Hmm. I don't remember hating it. I just remember maybe I just thought it was just good. I don't know what stuck in my craw that I didn't like about it at this point.
Oh, I think the special... I remember you having a problem with the CGI.
Oh. That would cause it to be a 4.
Mm-hmm. And I feel of us might have taken issue with the Doctor using a TARDIS, like blowing up a TARDIS. Even though it wasn't her TARDIS, just blowing up a TARDIS.
That's weird, too. I'll probably at this point say that it's probably like an AB for me, so. What were you other two? You were both at least A, I assume?
So we had S, A or S, and then B or A.
So that'd probably
average out to about an A. Yeah.
I guess it. Yeah, I guess so.
So, the Halloween apocalypse?
Halloween Apocalypse. So this episode introduces 8 plot lines, resolves only one of them. I don't think there was ever a chance. Like, this is the one that we watched it and we were like, we can't rate Flux episode by episode originally.
Mm.
Oh.
So I think this is our this first is that goes in the can't rate on its own. Yeah.
Frick. Yeah. Yeah, it's either that absolute bottom can't rate on its own, or I would honestly even just say, like, DRF.
Yeah, this is what DRF for me as well. This is like, what the hell are you trying to do? This is just a whole bunch of setup, and it's going nowhere right now.
So would you say you'd rather DRF over the cannot rate on its own?
Yeah,
that's what
mean.
I was thinking.
Because it's like, it's the to me, it's the one time. Like, I am very forgiving of the Chibnall era, but this is one time where I'm like, no.
I'm willing to put this at the very easy DRF.
If we're going to do that, I would lean more toward D just because I really like the opening.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That gets it to 1.0 instead of the 0.
You fail an episode, you still fail an episode.
Mm.
So I guess, considering that's the closest it cannot rate on its own, I guess that means we're rating literally every episode then.
Mm-hmm. War of the Suntarans.
There's
one where I put a question mark, but it's this one is, yeah, if we rated this, we're rating that.
Yeah.
War of the Suntarans. So this is the edutainment for this season, but I won't let a lack of teaching about the Crimean War tear it down too much. Honestly, it's a good episode. I would say A to S range.
Yeah, not having rewatched it, I would say, like, don't know if I can go as high as S, but definitely, like, either A or, like, a high B. I mean, the main takeaway that I can recall from this is that Chibnall gave us classic-era-looking Suntarans again. It's the best they've potentially ever looked.
Yeah,
and
I think that was the main takeaway at the time. This is the best the Suntarans have ever looked.
Yeah.
And one of their better stories, to which I also agree with about an A. It's like a low A at the very least. So agreement on A.
Yep.
So once upon a time.
So once upon time, this is the one I had a question mark of if it was okay to rate it on its own. But again, we rated the Halloween Apocalypse, so I guess we're rating this one.
Ooh, we gonna rate it, boy.
I didn't write much in the way of notes. I said it's probably C tier.
C tier for Bill. Alex.
Yeah, I don't remember all that much about this, which should really says a lot.
This is the episode where they're like scattered across the time stream and like they keep seeing each other.
Ah, yeah.
It felt like another really, really boring setup episode. And
yeah,
we saw more stuff that made the fugitive doctor into an unlikable doctor.
Yeah, without having rewatched it, yeah, I'll agree on a C.
I did agree C or D, so I assume we're just going to sit here with a C.
Sounds like it.
Little basement. All right. Brother, yeah.
Village of the Angels.
Oh.
Honestly, this episode raises more questions than answers.
Actually, Survivors of the Flux.
Go ahead. Oh, so yeah, so that was a problem with how I uploaded it. I accidentally gave them the same number. Village of the Angels actually came first.
Oh.
That was my mistake when I uploaded it.
Whoops.
But yeah, Village of the Angels is probably the best Weeping Angels story we've had, maybe even since the RTD era, in that it at least follows the lore that was set before it. So I would say maybe an A episode on this one.
Yeah, I'd say A or B. I generally remember War of the Suntarans and this were the two standout episodes for us. In that, I think, like, it was to the point that Randy was like, can we just rate these two on their own? Because it was like, these were the two that felt like they could have, because in a way, it's kind of like a double-edged sword, because they both felt so, like, kind of tacked on. in a way.
But at the same
time,
so better built than the rest of it.
They're the separate stories in the midst of this one long story.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I remember this also being like an AB for.
If nothing else, it gets an A for giving us the image of the Doctor as a weeping angel.
So I,
which I still want that toy, goddammit. I want that statue, fucking BBC, do it.
See, I guess this averages out to a low A.
I guess so.
Mm.
All right, Survivors of the Flux.
Survivors of the Flux was another one that on my notes I said we can't rate it on its own. It's all set up for the next episode, although it does have some decent moments. This is basically the Grand Tour in 1904. I did not mean to rhyme that, but I did.
Oh. I remember not being very thrilled by that.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like its own episode, so if we're rating it, I would give it a C. It feels like it's all set up for the ending, and, well, I don't have great things to say about the ending.
You're saying C, I'm saying D. Alex.
Ooh. Yeah, like, you know what? I'll give it a C because it had that really kick-ass Kate Stewart stuff in it that I can remember. Like, just looking over a summary, it's like, oh yeah, this reintroduced Kate Stewart and gave her something to do.
It did, but I would not consider that a plus. And that's part of my notes for The Vanquishers.
So
what I wrote here, because I was, yeah. The Grand Serpent plot comes out of nowhere in the last two episodes, and I take umbrage with the sudden arrival of a time traveler in any story where it's not established in any way that they are a time traveler. It really feels like several episodes were dropped, but the subplots from them were kept. The ending is almost a setup for a fourth Chibnall season, even though there was never a fourth Chibnall season planned. And I wrote all these notes before I even remembered the Three Doctors thing. So, probably a D episode for me.
Yeah, I think it ended up being confirmed that it was originally going to be a full... Well, I say full. It was going to be a 10-episode
series. It was
going to
be a few episodes longer, yeah.
Yeah, and they had to either cut them due to COVID or...
I'm pretty sure that was why.
Like, yeah,
they had a shortened production window or something.
Yeah.
For a reason, a shortened window, yeah.
Hmm. So it would be interesting to see what Flux would have turned out like with the extra two. I don't think it would have been like, you know, amazing necessarily.
I don't think it saved it.
There probably would have been some stuff that made a bit more sense, if nothing else. Yeah, having not rewatched it, and I think we all kind of were like collectively, yeah, no, this was a failed experiment. I would go for either C or D.
I would have gone with F, but given where we're at, I guess the medium is D.
Yep.
Even the
Did you notice only two of the Flux episodes got higher than B?
Yep. So Eve of the Daleks. So at this stage, I did not rewatch the ones past this, but they're also less than 2 years old. Eve of the Daleks is now a little more than 2 years old. It's a standard time loop episode, except with Daleks that seemed to be pulling their punches. I think that's why we rated it so low in the first place, was because it involved a lot of assumptions that didn't make a lot of sense. So C tier, I'd say.
Yeah, I think there was like, I was probably high on it until we started discussing it and yous were able to make me realize certain stuff. So I was like, oh, okay, yeah. And that brought my vote down.
Yeah, with a 3.5, you and I were the high ones.
Yeah. So yeah, I'd agree with you there. Oh, the C.
You're on the C. I would have been at a D. I do recall this being a really good idea that flubbed it. So we're going to give it a C. It's a low grade C.
Exactly, a C. Legend of the Sea Devils. This episode is decent, but ironically, considering the topic, it's kind of dry at times, which drags what could have been an A or an S down to a B, C tier.
Yeah, I'd say it's a B. The main thing that I remember coming out of this was, oh, hey, sea devils that actually look like sea devils.
And they're not terrible to look at either.
Yeah, like, again, that was one, like, if Chibnall gave us nothing else, it was not good updates on classic designs.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, that's sadly the only thing he did well. Yeah. And I also would agree with the B tier. It was interesting to see Sea Devils back in action again and doing decent. It's just so sad that it was a mediocre story.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right, and then the final one, The Power of the Doctor. This is a solid episode. It's got Ace, it's got Tegan, it's got other returning companions, it's got returning doctors. I would say this is an easy S tier.
Yeah, I pretty much have to agree. This is, like, before I was saying that, like, Revolution of the Daleks was potentially, at one point, at least for me, it was the best thing Chibnall had written for Doctor Who. Power of the Doctor is the best thing he's ever written for Doctor Who for me. It is like, and again, I joked about it when we covered it, but having seen the 60th specials now, it was absolutely more of a 60th anniversary special than we got. So, like, even if you can argue about the quality of writing RTD versus Chibnall, Power of the Doctor felt way more like a celebration of the entire show as opposed to just hooray modern Who.
I honestly can't remember what I rated this thing.
You were the low ball with a 4.0.
Oh. So I would have probably been an AB, which still lands it more or less a S, doesn't it? Because you two are S's. And I still am in the A section a little bit.
Well,
so
S, S, and A would be an A. S, S, and B would be an A. I think I said that wrong. S, S, and A would be an S. S, S, and B would be an A. So.
But I'm in A, B area, so.
Oh, got you.
I think it still leans up just enough to allow it an S, I guess.
I guess so.
So there it is.
So then what were the two episodes we have an S then?
Spyfall Part 1 and Power of the Doctor.
Oh, okay.
And our two low bowers are two Flux episodes, The Vanquishers and The Halloween Apocalypse.
Want to click the download button so that we can have access to this?
Save our download, sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Download.
All right, so here we have our tier list. Mostly A's, which, I mean, I guess it makes sense because it's his first season was both really well-liked by the public and by us. And then it kind of went a little bit down with the second season and then a lot down with the third season.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's our tier list here reflects that.
Basically.
Mm-hmm. What did you two think of, very briefly, since we don't have a lot, since we're running over time, what do you think of this format? Do you think this is something you'd want to do again? I have a few more on the schedule, but we can always change it if we don't like it.
I'd be down for doing this again.
Yeah, I'd be fine with this. We need to kind of get the motion going a little bit faster next time, but otherwise I wasn't against this at all, yeah.
And for the first season, we spent 5 minutes discussing each episode, and that dragged on.
I was starting to feel it drag on. I'm like, I'm getting tired, actually.
Yeah.
All right. Go ahead.
I was almost thinking in a way, it'll be a matter of trying to limit like what me and Matt say down. So you're effectively giving like, this is what this episode was doing. What do we give it? Yeah. Kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. When it's this much, if we're not covering as much,
we can maybe ramble a little bit. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have one
person whose natural speaking voice is a little slower than the others. which crops up in now and then.
Hmm.
All right. So I'm gonna put the link to this generator in the description, as well as the link to our image. Let us know what you think. Maybe go ahead and make your own tier list and send it to us on Twitter or something. Don't forget to like the video if you've listened this far. Subscribe on YouTube to get our exports every week, or follow us on Twitch to get notified when we stream. Next time we meet, we'll be premiering our 20th season. We're aiming for February 13 if nobody gets sick that week. Can't promise based on our recent history. And we will revisit the regeneration episodes of Doctor Who. See you then.
Good evening.
Oh, I probably should have had the TARDIS sound effect queued up, but oh, see you then.
Well then.